What defines a generation? Is it just about the year you were born? Or is there something more? We may have lived through different decades, different circumstances, different countries, but we all share in the global everyday push for our rights, for justice, for a world that is equal. Perhaps what defines our generation isn't our age, or our background, but the line in the sand that we have drawn. We take to the streets to speak out against discrimination, and we work tirelessly behind the scenes. We stand up for peace.
We are fed up with the war.
And economic justice. We start with a statement and watch it become a movement. We have come a long way. But the fight isn't over, and our rights are still under assault. It is time to take action. Let us be the wake-up call the world needs.
The eyes of all future generations are upon you.
Be the first, the youngest, the best, and then make sure no one is left behind. When someone tries to silence you, raise up your voice.
Let us wage a global struggle.
Change everything, or change just one thing. As long as you do something, whether you're new to changing the world or have been in the fight for a long time.
Each knows exactly why we are here.
We are all together, united for gender equality. And the future we create for women and girls is up to all of us.
Good day, one and all. I am Constance Newman, the chair of the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network. I'm here to welcome you to the 2020 Renaissance Women of Diaspora Summit on Gender and Race Discrimination. You're going to meet the hosts of the summit in just a few minutes. But I have some other business I have to take care of first, and that is to introduce the co-moderator of the summit. It's Dakota Gant, the youth representative of the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network. And it's our job. We know you're expecting us to do our job. And our job is to move the program on time, informative, and yes, very interesting way. We'll promise you we're going to do our best to follow your directions. Dakota, I would like to begin the summit by asking you a question about the summit. And the question is this: what should the viewers and program participants expect to hear about, to learn, to question? What should they expect out of this valuable time they're taking out of their lives? So Dakota, take it away.
We can expect to bring more information about discrimination on the African continent, in Canada, Great Britain, and the United States. There will be consideration for the health issues that exist as a result of discrimination. And importantly, the speakers will not only identify the problems, but will also engage in ways to end gender and race discrimination. We will also be discussing a topic of special concern to me as a U.S. youth representative, and that is the discrimination against youth in the diaspora, a subject that I felt had often been underrepresented, but a truly important topic for the future of the world. And when we examine this topic, and we focus even more intently on the crosshairs between generation, age, gender, and race, we find an even more concentrated subsection of rampant discrimination, which needs to be highlighted in forums such as this. However, youth organizations such as Rajalnu, which I am a part of, are working hard combating these injustices all throughout the diaspora by facing these challenges head on and refusing to bow to systemic oppression and discrimination. So I hope that gives you an idea of what these speakers will be bringing. Now I have to ask you a question. What do we want to know about the speakers and their personal journeys in a world of race and gender discrimination?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. We're going to know already just from who they are that they are steeped in the topic, and they're going to know so much about the topic. But what we're going to want to do is kind of peek into their lives. To find out whether they ever face discrimination. Now, they can't fool us, but they can try. We're pretty certain that everybody has at least had some experience that seemed like discrimination, and we're going to want to hear about that. The other thing is that we have a series of questions that have come in from all over the world, and one of them is one I wouldn't have brought up front, but I think it'll show how interesting we're going to try to make it. And that question is based on the assumption that it's men. They're the problem. They're the ones responsible for all this mess. No. The question is, to what extent are women also involved in being part of the problem, not just being part of the solution? That is a question that came from one of the people participating. I think it came from Benin, but we have questions from all over. But you didn't ask me another question, which I wanted you to ask me. And that question is, what next? And I guess I would say that the viewers and participants will have a charge after these two and a half hours and a responsibility to do what they can in their own arenas to address discrimination. Each person should find like-minded people and join forces to address the problems, because there's always strength in numbers. Finally, this summit is a part of a series of webinars conducted by the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network. We're going to call it ARDEN along the way, but I wanted to just let you know we've got a full name. We will encourage all to participate in the future activities to join efforts to design effective solutions to the problems in the world associated with discrimination of women and girls. Now it gives me great honor and privilege to introduce the co-hosts, Dr. Jibril Diallo, Dr. Natalia Conniff, and Her Excellency S.B. Campbell Barr. So, Jibril.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Connie. First Vice President of Costa Rica, Her Excellency S.B. Campbell Barr, Dr. Natalia Conniff, Executive Director of UNFPA, without whose outstanding support we would not have been here. The Right Honorable Michael Jean, whose work I've had the chance to follow over the years. Dr. Jonathan Cole, Honorable Constance Newman, that you have heard, and all of you here, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I would say, gentlemen, I'm only the only man so far. So I would say, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network, I would like to thank you again for joining us at this first Women of the Diaspora Summit. This summit follows from the Equal Light Red Card campaign launch, which many of you remember happened at the United Nations headquarters in New York on the 6th of March, earlier this year. Equal Light envisions a world characterized by equity, equality, and inclusion. A world where those who have been traditionally marginalized or underrepresented are uplifted and empowered. Within this framework, the Red Card campaign, I have the Red Card here, the Red Card campaign seeks to put an end to gender-based violence and discrimination. Violence and discrimination against women and girls are inexcusable violations of the rules and norms of society, and they must not be tolerated. By signing the Red Card pledge, stakeholders commit to giving a red card to all forms of discrimination and violence against women and girls. And we would like to work with you to get 1 million signatures by November 2022, which is the beginning of the FIFA World Cup. I therefore urge those of you who have not done so to go online on www.redcardpledge.com and sign the red card. A link to the red card is also available at the bottom of the website for the summit. I would like to take this opportunity to recognize and express my appreciation to my sisters, First Vice President FC Campbell Ba, who has been so available to us in spite of her very, very busy schedule. Dr. Natalia Kanem, Undersecretary General of the United Nations, Executive Director of UNFPA. Fumzile Mlambo Nguka, the Executive Director of UN Women. Dr. Jonathan Cole, here present, who is at the head of an organization with 3 million members, and the chair of the board of AIDN, Honorable Constance Newman. All of these women and all of you here are champions for women and girls everywhere. In order to stay in power, some governments have done or gone the dark path of using nationalistic and populist ideologies, exploiting rather than celebrating differences among people and nations. Fortunately, there are governments such as Costa Rica, through the leadership of President Carlos Alvarado and First Vice President FC Campbell, who have been continuing to shine forth a light of hope by embracing and committing to an agenda of inclusivity and human rights for all, regardless of gender, race, or distinctions. We still live in a male-dominated world where a male-dominated culture exists, with men at all levels trying to dictate or to force upon women and girls what those women and girls need to think, what they need to feel, and what they need to do, even on matters that are fundamental, such as matters of their own personhood. UNFPA, under the outstanding leadership of Undersecretary General Natalia Kanem, has been at the front lines of the battle against the rising regressive forces that seek to diminish the rights of women and girls over their choices, bodies, and lives. I also salute the remarkable work done by Dr. Jonetta Cole. I've had the chance to follow her work over the years, and she has been at the front lines of trying to break the glass ceilings, the concrete ceilings behind those glass ceilings that have been hampered the full realization of equality. We're meeting at the time of the United Nations General Assembly. This is the 75th anniversary of the United Nations. And we know that women and girls from the diaspora are doubly burdened due to their gender and also due to their ancestry. We are therefore today here because we know that together we can, and we are actually creating a better world. And together, if each and every one of us is willing to join hands, march forward, fight, cry if necessary, demand, dare, and scream, we are the people. We can create the world we want. And that world is the world where peace prevails and all people under this sky are truly free. Thank you very much.
Dr. Cannon, did you have a few remarks you wanted to make at this time? Or
absolutely. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Connie. I would like to call the names of Queen Nzinga, Nana Asanteya, Nanny of the Maroons, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, Angela Davis, Mariela Franco, Shirley Chisholm, Marisa Conde, Maria Mamba, Susana Baca, Cesaria Evora, Nina Simone, Zora Neale Hurston, Tarana Burke, Johnetta Cole, Dame Billy Miller, Peggy Antrobus, Tony Cade Bambara, Epsi Campbell, Michaela Jean, and Aya Chebi as I begin. These are influential names in my personal sphere who have led me through the history of Africa to the present moment where we find ourselves now in desperate need of the leadership of women of the African diaspora. Almost a year ago, we celebrated together progress made in our journey towards gender equality and women's empowerment. The idea of bodily integrity is a fundamental pillar of our understanding of the Black woman and the exercise of full choice over our own bodies and lives. In Nairobi, at that momentous summit in November last year, partners from government, from the private sector, from civil society, from academia, youth leaders, grassroots women, people with disabilities, and Afrodescendientes were front and center in this new moment of the debate on rights and choices and making that a reality for women of the world. There have been more than 1,000 commitments, over 1,250 coming out of the Nairobi summit. And in this era of COVID, we now see our hands, our hearts, and our intellect are needed by this world more than ever before. COVID-19 reminds us just how vital the lives of Black women are to balance on the planet. I would say the same for Indigenous women. The discriminatory laws and policies and norms that continue to impede women's and girls' bodily autonomy and limit full access to sexual and reproductive health and rights, limit equal pay for equal work. These antecedents have made justice elusive for some of us. And in fact, at a time when we say Black lives matter, I look forward to this discussion today. I believe that partnership is going to be a big, important reason for us to accelerate the development and not let go of 2030 as our ultimate goal. So, my sisters, let us continue to say we shall overcome, but also to demand the actions that go along with that. And let us lift every voice and sing, full of that faith, full of that hope, and looking towards a rising sun for Africa and for all of us as daughters of Africa. We will march on until victory is won. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Dr. Constance.
Thank you so much for those very inspiring remarks, and we look forward to spending more time with you. I'd like to ask now Her Excellency, S.V. Campbell-Barr, if you would now share your remarks.
Thank you very much. I want to say hello to everyone, especially to Natalia Kahneman and to Jibril Diallo, because we are doing this. It's a distinguished guest participants, dear friends. It is a great honor for me to be co-host in this Women of Diaspora Summit, an event organized in this context of middle term of the International Decade of People of African Descent, the Decade of Action of SDGs, and the Black Lives Matter movement. Women of African descent have without doubt the strength and resilience of our ancestors, who are able to overcome great obstacles by taking extraordinary steps to achieve rights, justice, democracy. We are part of a generation of brave men and women, fighters capable of turning history and loss into freedom and pain into hope. And that is why we have to join the force to support the demands of young people crying out for recognition, justice, development, and for the eradication of racism around the world. As Vice President of Costa Rica, a country that's carried forward the banner of human rights, I'm committed to continue raising national, regional, and global action for the eradication of racism and discrimination in all forms and expression in order to advance towards equality, justice, and inclusion for all. As an Afro-descendant leader for years, I have worked with various movements for social justice. In my political leadership now, I have the responsibility to assume international leadership so that the agenda of rights of African descendant people and women is a priority. It must be a real priority in the decision of multilateral intergovernmental organization, as well as transnational and local companies. I would like to thank Jibril Diallo for the leadership. Mr. Diallo and his team have been an extraordinary ally for the efforts made by Costa Rica to achieve progress in the region, guarantee and protecting the rights and dignity of Afro-descendants in all their diversity. Equality, justice, recognition, and development should be on all the agendas for all members of our society, for which female leaders of the diaspora must strengthen our bonds, generate alliance, and promote agreements to guarantee the life and the safety of children, young people, women, and men from our communities and from the most excluded sectors. Dear friends, during the second panel, I will present to you Costa Rica's proposal to carry out a regional campaign against racism, as well the initiative to declare 31st of August as International Day of People of African Descent. I know that we also have the support of Natalia, an extraordinary woman, Afro-descendant, as a model for many girls in our region, and also from Pumzile, a wonderful, strong, and determined African woman who has given great contribution to the world. I also know that we will be my alliance to strengthen the women's rights agenda and to consolidate the sixth African region in the Union, in the African Union, with the conviction that today, more than ever, we must unite and identify efforts to in this fight against racism, racial discrimination, and related intolerance. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your very strong contribution that you make each day. And we're all so proud. We're just so proud of you. And we take credit for you, even though we shouldn't. So what I want to do now, Dakota, do you want to go to the next part of the program?
Yes. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce the guest speaker, Her Excellency, the Right Honorable Michael Jean, former Governor General and Commander-in-Chief of Canada, former Secretary General of the International Organization of La Francophonie.
Thank you so much, Dakota, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, dear friends. Who better to talk about discrimination based on gender and race than us, Afro-descendant women? I have a thought right this moment for our sisters and friends, French-speaking, Creole-speaking, who will not be able to join an English-only conference for lack of interpretation. The reason I feel sorry is because we, the women of Haiti, for example, are heirs of this heroic feast that successfully proclaimed the abolition of the slave trade and slavery and gave birth to the first Black Republic in the world. On the 75th anniversary of the United Nations, let us remind ourselves that the preamble to the Charter, "We, the peoples of the United Nations," includes "we, the women." Today is our opportunity to reaffirm that we, the women of the diaspora, come to assert the importance of our existence, the profound, and I dare say, universal significance of our experience to the world, to its past, present, and future. We, the women of the diaspora, come from 400 years of humiliation, abject violence, untold cruelty, and endless suffering, the infamous outrage that was the slave trade, one of the darkest chapters in human history. We, the women of the diaspora, come from a gruesome history based on the deprivation of humanity amongst millions of enslaved men and women stripped of the entirety of their rights. We, the women of the diaspora, bear the marks and scars of our many different yet almost universal colonial experiences. We, the women of the diaspora, were targeted by some of the most abusive and barbarous acts ever perpetrated against human beings, including rape, the ultimate weapon of domination and submission. Today, we, the women of the diaspora, are coming together to raise our voices. "Ain't I a woman?" said Sojourner Truth, her strong, whole-souled tone of voice resonating straight to our hearts after nearly 170 years. Sojourner Truth, American abolitionist and women's rights activist, born into slavery, who escaped with her infant daughter to freedom in 1826 and later went to court to recover her son sold as a slave, and became the first Black woman to win such a case against a white man. Like Sojourner Truth, how many Black female heroes in the same struggle to live free spoke up at once against the raw violence of male dominance and that of white supremacy? Women and men who lived in the flesh, the call for human purpose and emancipation, were equally driven by a sense of universal humanity, the realization that we all have inalienable rights by virtue of our very nature as human beings. If only we could put together the many untold stories of us women in this struggle and the perspectives with which we fought. We Afro-Caribbean, Afro-Latin American, Black Canadian, African American, Afro-descendants in South Asia and Europe, all of us hold special knowledge, stories that speak to our relationship with the world, how much our fighting spirit remains. We are all different, yet we recognize each other. At the beginning of my mandate as Governor General and Commander-in-Chief of Canada, I decided my first state visits would be to the African continent, which I toured over years from north to south, from Algeria to South Africa. While I sought to engage with women on the continent of our origins, I realized how much of it still runs through my veins. Everywhere I went, I was welcomed as the long gone one coming back home. I didn't know the languages, but the rhythms and dances were immediately recognized, preserved for centuries deep within Haitian culture, an ultimate and indelible artifact of our intangible cultural heritage, remnants of an identity of which we were robbed. My body would respond and I would join the dance, instantly swaying on familiar ground. It was very moving. Women would ask, but how do you know our dance? I would say, your dance is our dance and our dance is your dance. I would tell them the story of how we women and men who were forcibly deported to be enslaved, made landless, deprived of our humanity, turned into beasts of burden, pieces of property, resisted, because we did resist. How we fought to reclaim our dignity, including with music, body rhythms, the few scattered words we kept, a spirit of revolt, our special prayers to escape the worst and be reborn to ourselves on our long journey towards emancipation. All over the continent, I engaged fully with the foundational density of African cultures. From the perspective of women, based on our condition, I may be threading on tricky terrain, but we must also talk about the twin jaws of the vise that squeeze Black women's lives. Oh, how we have felt and still feel the pain in the shared predicament of our brothers. I hurt just to touch upon it here. For centuries, the Black man was humiliated and demeaned, including in his relationship with women. When the master had the absolute right to dispose sexually of female slaves and to make children who would be treated better from the outset, it was for the Black man and the Black woman alike the deepest abasement. When their children could be sold away, it was devastating. As the Black woman was reduced to chattel and livestock reproduction, the Black man was forced into non-existence, made to erase himself. Does this wretched experience over centuries explain the difficulty assuming his role within the family? I dare ask the question. The number of Black single mothers in the Americas forces me to ask the question. I know the subject is sensitive. The facts are recurring and troubling. It is a thorny situation. The subject remains taboo, but we must talk about it. For our mothers who raise their sons and daughters alone, for the children who instantly learn to live without the presence of a father, I know what costs this imposes on us. I dare submit the question to you, our brothers. How can we explain this persistent pattern of headlong flight? We would like to have you stand at our side. We would like to count on you as allies in the daily grind, as well as in the larger struggle for the full recognition of our human rights. Because we women of the diaspora are hurting in your absence. We, the women, know what it means to act for our families, our communities, and the common good in the best interest of the whole, because such is our experience. It always was. We deal with it every day of our lives, in our struggle for the respect of our physical and psychological integrity, our sexual and reproductive rights, the full recognition of our many contributions to the development and growth of our countries. We who carry the weight of double and triple workloads around essential economic activities and initiatives, yet too often remain confined to the informal sphere. We can identify fully with the pillar values of the International Decade for People of African Descent, proclaimed by the United Nations. Recognition, justice, development. These are our demands for ourselves and for the whole community. To achieve gender equality, and empower all women and girls to build a more just and equitable world, what we, women of the diaspora, hold and carry, what we have to say, our witness, our experiences, our understanding of reality, all of it is essential. So I can't wait to hear what you all will contribute. This is our summit, dear women of the diaspora. So let's make the most of it. Because our lives matter, sisters. Brothers, our lives matter. Much love. Thank you. Merci en pile.
Thank you so much. Those are so powerful, I think, thoughts for us, and will help us in the following hours to come up with more brilliance to add to that you put on the table. Dakota, you want to introduce the video?
Actually, at this time, I would like to introduce or have more remarks by Dr. Jibril Diallo.
Thank you. I've been asked to read a special message from Kumzile Mlangonguka and Vinny Bunyima, and it reads as follows. Our sisters, congratulations on this amazing and powerful convening, bringing together so many inspiring women of the diaspora. We have written this joint message for all of you because though we are not able to make this year's summit, we are keen to work every more closely alongside you to fight racism and fight patriarchy. We greet you in two roles, professional and personal. For us, these are inseparable. We are privileged to lead agencies in the United Nations and to co-chair the Senior Africans Group of UN executive leaders from the continent or of African descent who are working to drive change to help the United Nations realize fully the vision of being an anti-racist institution. We are also two African women who are part of this diaspora. Today, we are outside our countries and our continent because most of the headquarters are in the global north. In previous years, we were forced to leave our countries and our continent because they were not free. We are mothers, and we grieve as mothers for the Black young people who cannot breathe under the knees of brutal law enforcement, or who cannot breathe when held down by social and economic marginalization. We know that the most powerful force to fighting these injustices is the power of Black sisterhood. You are in the vanguard of that sisterhood. We are proud to walk alongside you. These inequalities of race, gender, and class, which scar our whole world, have been exacerbated by COVID-19 and by a confluence of crises in economic, politics, and society. The fraying of multilateralism between the shortage of international solidarity is entangled also in racial privilege and in unjust relations between the global North and South. Now is an especially critical time for an active and organized diaspora community working for racial and gender justice in every country and working for a multilateralism rooted in equality and solidarity to reset relations between countries. following the brutal murder of George Floyd, senior African and diaspora leaders from across the United Nations came together in an uncompromising joint call for action. We noted that the killing was, quote, rooted in a wider and intractable set of issues that will not disappear if we ignore them. And we declared it is time for the United Nations to step up and act decisively to help end systemic racism against people of African descent and other minority groups. It was at the height of the civil rights movement in the United States and during the emergence of post-colonial independent African nations joining the United Nations that the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination and All Forms of Racial Discrimination came into force in 1969. Let's all bear in mind the admonition of civil rights leader Fannie Lou Hamer, quote, nobody's free until everybody's free. The defeat of apartheid in South Africa, driven in part by the United Nations, was one of the organization's proudest achievements. We are clear that today, the United Nations must do more and must lead the transformation the world needs. We are clear too, as we declared in our call to action, that if we are to lead, we must do so by example. To initiate and sustain real change, we also must have an honest assessment of how we uphold the United Nations Charter within our institution. To change the world, the United Nations must also change itself. We know that we have not done enough. We are asking our teams to listen to Black movements, to hear what we need to do differently. It is not enough to be non-racist. We must be anti-racist. We recognize the responsibility we hold in that change to amplify and facilitate the work of many thousands and thousands of determined activists and organizers, and to honor those who have gone free before us. We want to salute the courage of everyone around the world who has stood up to insist that Black lives matter. Especially, we want to pay tribute to the Black young people who are leading a social transformation. We ask all of you here, our sisters, we need your guidance and your help. And we also need you to keep challenging us to demand the highest of us. Justice is never given. It is always won. And as Martin Luther King noted, change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but it comes through continuous struggle. This fight against racism and against patriarchy is impossible for any of us to win alone. But together, we Black sisters are unstoppable. Thank you for all you do, and it is an honor to be by your side. Signed, Phumzile Mlanguka and Winnie Bunyama. Phumzile Mlanguka, Executive Director of UN Women, and Winnie Bunyama, Executive Director of UNAIDS, in capacity as co-chairs of UN Senior African Group. I thank you.
Thank you so much for those remarks. Before I introduce the next video, I would like to join all of our viewers to join us on social media. Follow the hashtag Diaspora Women's Summit, please. And that's where we will continue this conversation. We encourage you to tweet, like, and share this entire summit. Earlier this year, protests about police abuse of women became a global cause, starting with a performance piece created in Chile. The Guardian produced a 2-minute video that documents the power, intensity, and spread of the Un Velador en Tu Camino.
digo es la violencia que ya ves, es femicidio, impunidad para el asesino.
Thank you so much. We're certain that you will agree with us that that is a very powerful statement. Before going to the first session, I want to be very boring and share the rules of the session. We have limited time, and the embarrassment of riches of many outstanding people who are here today to share their thoughts. So that what we have agreed to is each presenter on the panel will have between 3 and 5 minutes to make their remarks. I have some homemade signs that I put together myself that I'll hold up when you're 2 minutes. And then when you have 1 minute left, and then the final sign, thank you very much. That will be your hint to move along. But other than that, the whole experience should be very pleasant. But what we're doing is we're trying to have time for each person to speak. And then after the panel, individuals in the panel speak, we're hoping that there will be some exchange between the members of the panel. So we've timed it for that. We're just not trying to be difficult. With that, I'd like to introduce the first session. Dr. Cannon is the chair, and we look forward to hearing from her. And then I will introduce the members of the panel, and then we'll all work together for a give and take. So Dr. Cannon.
Thank you so much, Connie. And let me just start by saying that the fundamental principle of the Declaration of Human Rights is that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and human rights. So my only question as we kick off the discussion, and it's such a fantastic panel that I will abbreviate any introduction that I would want to say to this. The question is why? Why discrimination against women on the basis of gender and race? And the other question is, what are we going to do about that? The call to action that we're looking for, knowing that in the Americas and actually across the diaspora, women of African descent are disproportionately represented. We tend to be overrepresented in informal labor markets, in deaths from COVID, and whatever it is, you name it, that intersection has really been lethal for us. And I think there are a lot of interesting things going on in terms of how it is that Black women are standing up in the face of gender and racial discrimination together, and what we're doing in those intersectional spaces. for me, the issue around modern contraceptive choice, why it is that Black women are the ones who tend to die in higher numbers during childbirth. And as part of the video that we just saw, the levels of violence, the levels of child marriage, the levels of female genital mutilation, this is something that our community can address and overcome. So thank you for fielding this discussion, and I will yield the rest of my time so we can get right to it. I'm very excited to hear what this other panelist will say. Thank you.
Thank you. The first two speakers, let me just introduce them by a couple of questions that we don't expect you to answer if it's not your plan right away. But we do hope that when we have the give and take, you can share some thoughts on the general questions. My question for the Honorable Diane Abbott is that you were the first Black woman to become a British member of Parliament. We want you to share the secret that we know you know about what it is really, what's keeping women out of power, the real power. What is it that you were able to experience that help us all know what it takes to get into the meeting before the meeting and the meeting after the meeting? Dr. Cole, you have had experiences in the public and private sector, very powerful positions. And we know that in those positions, you have examples of steps to take to erase gender and race discrimination. And you also know what's been tried and doesn't work. And so either now or later, we would want you to share some of that with us. And some of this is based, some of these questions are based on the questions that have been sent in to us. So people will be out there listening to see whether we paid attention to their hard work of sending in questions. So may I start with the Honorable Diane Abbott.
Can you hear me properly?
Yes.
Very good. I'm honored to be at this important event for women of the African diaspora. Diaspora is, of course, people of Africa descent who are scattered all over the world. Some of us, because of very early migration, sometimes people forget that Moors from Africa ruled Spain on the European continent for 800 years. Most of us, through slavery, empire, colonialism, and modern day migration. My own family's story, it's out of Africa via the Caribbean. My forebearers were Black slaves on the sugar plantations of Jamaica. My parents came to the UK after the Second World War, and I was born here in Britain. My parents were ordinary working class migrants who left school at 14. They could never have dreamt that their daughter would have become a member of the British Parliament, one of the Black women out of 650 members of Parliament. I was asked, how do women get into power? How do we move forward to political power? Well, first of all, I believe we have to know our history. I know if you go back to the history of the African continent, there are very many powerful Black women in leadership roles. And I'm talking about going back centuries. So we have to know our history, because one of the things that undermines us, both as men and women, is that we take ourselves at white people's estimation. We don't know our own history.
I'm going to interrupt you for a minute. It's breaking up, and I'm going to see if there's anything we can do. It's probably on our end. Gordon?
Actually, Actually, if you could just move back a little bit and speak a little softer, because I think you're getting a reverb from your mic. Sorry.
Okay, now is this better? Is this better? Less reverb?
Somehow.
All right.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's fine. All I was saying is, how do we get into the position of power politically? And I'm saying we have to know our own history. Have to believe in ourselves as individual women, and we have to support each other, and not just support each other in our communities, but support each other internationally. One of the reasons I'm so pleased to be at this event is that it's an international event. So if we believe in ourselves, we support each other, not just in our community, but internationally, and if we unite internationally around specific demands around racial justice, I believe that we as diaspora can prevail. It was a British woman who said a century ago, power concedes nothing without a demand. We, the women of the African diaspora, have to come forward with our demands as a united and we can win the racial justice that we've waited so long for. The Black Lives Matter movement has had huge international impact. I believe we can build on that and move forward as a people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You didn't make me hold up. I did a lot of work on this card, so maybe Janetta will help me. Dr. Cole, you're next.
Thank you, Honorable Sister Connie Newman. My sisters, my brothers, my siblings all, what an honor it is for me to participate in this highly important virtual summit on ending systemic racism and sexism in the diaspora. Eradicating these twin scourges is not only a moral imperative, it benefits, or it would benefit, all of us throughout the world. Indeed, when women of Africa and the diaspora are empowered, families are healthier, young folk are better educated, businesses are more profitable, governments are more responsive to their people's needs, and there's less violence in the world. We women of the diaspora are the single largest untapped source of economic growth in the world. Think about how much better our communities, our nation, our world would be if we could put an end to systemic racism and systemic sexism. In my country, from the time that those first small group of African people arrived on the shores of what was then the colony of Virginia in the year 1619. Women of African descent have had to battle what the African American feminist and political activist Frances Beale coined as the double jeopardy of racism and sexism. And while racism and sexism have affected all women of the Africa diaspora, I'd like to take my remaining few moments to focus on the United States. Of course, some progress has been made. Oh, but my sisters, we have such a mighty long way to go to end systemic racism and sexism. Indeed, the vestiges of those twin scourges affect every aspect of our lives. To take just one example, employment. In the United States, a Black woman still only makes 68 cents for every dollar that a white American man makes. It just ain't fair. But the question that we have been given is, so what are we going to do about all of this? How do we bring an end to racism and sexism in the United States, throughout the diaspora, indeed throughout the world? Well, Honorable Sister Connie Newman, I came prepared. So here are my three, not just requests, but requirements. First, we need individuals and whole countries to own the existence of systemic racism and sexism. I love the words of African-American writer James Baldwin, who said, not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed that is not faced. One of the ways that we own it is through courageous conversations. One of the ways that we own it is exactly what we're doing today with this amazing and important conference. Secondly, we need individuals in the United States and around the world to take personal responsibility in working to end racism and sexism. When we witness or hear racist and sexist remarks, see systemic racism and sexism in action, we better stand up and speak out. And lastly, we need more individuals to become politically active and to support organizations and elected officials that will help end systemic racism and sexism. I want to really bring closure now.
Yes.
We women can do this. We can take the lead in doing this, because as an African proverb says, when women lead, streams run uphill. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Cole, for that was so powerful, and you have given us so much to think about. And we're recording, everybody, you should know that. So you're gonna hear some of this coming back. So be good, okay? Because it's gonna be over and over again, Dr. Cole, so thank you. Now, Dr. Sachs, we look forward to your comments. You have had extensive experience in projects around the world, particularly on the African continent. From those projects, we're just interested in knowing what do you think is the relationship between the government funding of health issues and the resulting health statistics of women? The answer now or later when we have a free-for-all. But we just think that that's something we need to try to understand. What is the real relationship between resources that are made available by governments and the end result? So Dr. Sachs.
Thank you. I first want to quickly review the fact that women indeed have more health issues and life and death issues compared to men. It's because of women's unique biological role in human procreation, which is complex and fraught with life-threatening hazards. What's not obvious and is not adequately addressed is how much of the added disease and death burden is attributable to gender discrimination. I'd like to make two quick points on active and what I call passive discrimination. In active discrimination, the type we are speaking about most of the time, including in this conference, a female is held in lower esteem than a male because of cultural, religious, ethnic, historical reasons. Discrimination, besides depriving a woman of her agency, contributes to injury, illness, and death. One, even before birth, discrimination causes loss of life with gender-based sex selection and pregnancy termination of a female fetus. During infancy, data shows more males than females surviving in places like India, indicating loss of infant girls, not for any innate biological reasons, but for societal biological ones, either emotional neglect and or physical neglect, such as inadequate nutrition or actual infanticide. Three, during girls' childhood, some communities still practice female genital mutilation. There are 200 million victims today with horrific short-term and long-term health consequences, including infections, bleeding, scarring, pain during sexual activity, and difficulty during childbirth because of obstructed labor, contributing to maternal and newborn deaths. During adolescence, especially where girls do not have access to school, there's still the practice of child marriage, forcing young girls to marry before sexual maturity. A girl is 5 times more likely than a boy to be married before reaching maturity, mainly in low-income countries. There are some 650 million such marriages. As a result, partly due to child marriage, there are teenage pregnancies, and they present health risks for both the mother and the newborn, who is at increased risk of prematurity, low birth weight, being small for gestational age, malformation, et cetera. There are countries like Mali, Chad, Angola, Mozambique, and others where up to a quarter of adolescents are pregnant. Sexual violence has been mentioned at any age, especially underage, is much more likely perpetrating it against women than men, inflicting innumerable physical and psychological problems, sexually transmitted diseases, bleeding, scarring, unwanted pregnancy, and not infrequently result in death. One more form of discrimination that is deleterious to women's health is the requirement for spousal authorization for using health services. This leads to women not getting the preventive and therapeutic care that they need. For instance, if a woman goes into labor but does not have her husband's approval, she often has to deliver her newborn in an unsafe home setting, not being granted access to tools and skilled birth attendants available at a clinic or hospital. But there's something that I call passive discrimination. There are communities that live in extreme poverty, such as rural sub-Saharan Africa, where often they do not have reliable access to even basic health services. This results in high disease and mortality burden, of course, that falling on both genders. However, it burdens and even kills women disproportionately more so because of women's sexual and reproductive role. The lack of basic reproductive health services, including emergency obstetric care, skilled birth attendants, emergency transport, is why we still lose 300,000 women who die in childbirth, which is a situation that kills two people often, the mother and the newborn, and leaves orphans. So in my opinion, tolerating the way we do, underfinance community health services in very low-income setting is a form of internationally sanctioned gender discrimination. And it is our duty and responsibility to change that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We already knew of your reputation. We knew we'd learn a great deal from you, and you haven't disappointed us. Next member of the panel, Chevy, the question for you is, do you think that the current crisis, COVID-19, unemployment, climate change, magnify past discrimination against women of color more than young men of color? You don't have to answer it now, but at some time while this panel is on, it would be helpful to get your thought on that.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me? Because I have very poor internet. Yeah, great. First, Madame Constance, you're the coolest chairwoman. I love those cards. I'm going to use them in my webinars. And it's such an honor to be here in this important platform. And before I start, I want to say in French to Honorable Michel Jean, je suis tellement inspirée par votre speech et merci pour votre message. I think that Madame Sachs gave a comprehensive overview on what's happening on the continent. And maybe I'll ask that question also a bit later, but I would just add that we also have all the frameworks, the progressive frameworks that we need. So at the African Union level, we have the Maputo Protocol, we have the African Youth Charter. At the UN level, we have the Resolution 1325. We were with you, Dr. Kahneman, and ICPD last year. And we also have a couple of things happening at the African Union. We launched yesterday, my office and Commissioner of Social Affairs, the Selima Youth Victorious Ambassadors. So we welcomed 6 young women from Africa and the diaspora to carry the agenda of ending female genital mutilation. We also released today, this morning, actually, the Saudi publication, the first ever blog of the African Union and showing 25 powerful stories of young women also from Africa and the diaspora as our 6th region about their resilience during COVID-19 outbreak, including survivals of sexual abuse. So I think what we're trying to do, at least at the African Union, is around opening the space for young women to drive Agenda 2063, to own our voice and our narrative, because at the end of the day, our struggle, my generation struggle, is a struggle for voice, to be listened to be taken seriously. And I think today, we don't wanna talk much about what government should do, because government know what they should do. They have all the frameworks they signed up for, they just need to be held accountable. So I wanna make maybe 2 reflections. One is for my mothers, which I consider as allies, and one for our feminist movement and the road to Beijing plus 25. So the question I wanna ask my mothers today is, what kind of word are you leaving for us? A word where young women are genitally mutilated, both in Africa and in the diaspora. A word where young women and girls are forced to early marriage, getting stripped of their right of choice in childhood. A word where we are silenced and invisible. We are harassed every single day. We are abused once in a while. A word where girls drop out of school just because of their periods, a word where we get paid less for the same job and even for doing better jobs than our counterparts, and all because of our gender, and in my case, age too. It's like a double crime to be young and female. So it's a violent word you're leaving for us. We did 22 youth consultations on COVID-19 the past 4 months, and the ultimate problem young women raise over and over again is gender-based violence. FGM is violence, child marriage is violence, rape is violence, cyber harassment is violence. They're all forms of violence patriarchy uses to keep women trapped in inequality. That's the deal. So to my mothers here and watching us, we need you. We need you to stand up for our issues, today's issues. You cracked the ceilings for your generation, and we need you with us to crack the ceilings of our time. We're in the age of technology. In one decade, everything changed with internet. See how many girls are violated and harassed and destroyed completely online. So I'll go quickly, since time is running, to my second reflection, which is the feminist movement, precisely African feminism. First, I am a proud Pan-African feminist because I believe there is no Pan-Africanism without feminism. The objectification of women is anti-Pan-African. It derives its roots from patriarchy, from colonialism, from racism. It is anti-Pan-African to reduce women to maternal function or to seek to control our bodies and minds and desires in the name of whatnot, culture and faith and all sorts of excuses. So, and also when I think about it, the first Pan-African organization was led by women, POW. I was in the 10th Congress in Namibia this February, and it's organization older than the African Union. So when we talk about solidarity between Africans in Africa and the diaspora, and how can we unite our issues, it's like, to me, simple, it's Pan-Africanism. So to the question what do we do about it? We know the issues. We should redefine Pan-Africanism and run with it. When we talk about Black Lives Matter and African youth ask me, we have our own racism issues here on the continent to deal with, you know, before going in solidarity with others. But I'm like, Black Lives Matter is about liberation first and foremost. And Pan-Africanism, in my definition, means my liberation is your liberation. We all win. So regardless of your struggle, if your struggle is for liberation, then we stand in solidarity, because amplifying Black Lives Matter means you amplifying your own justice issues too. And it's intersectional, it's climate, it's gender, it's racial justice, it's all of it. So when people ask me, what am I bringing with me to Beijing plus 25? I see I have 0 minutes, so I'll wrap up. I'm bringing to Beijing plus 25 Pan-Africanism. We're going to organize 6 convenings for 6 regions, including our diaspora. We're going to organize, we're coming to Beijing plus 25 with a manifesto of young Pan-African feminist women. We will bring our history, our struggle, our solution, and world leaders and bureaucratic institutions would have no choice but take us seriously. The last thing, Chair, if you allow me, I want to say that our Pan-African feminist movement must be intergenerational. I've been advocating and calling for a concept I call intergenerational co-leadership, which means if we are to fight gender equality, we have to bring all generations to the fight, your wisdom and our innovation. But you need to allow us to organize the way we want to organize, not the way it was in the 60s. You have to trust us to co-lead and invite us to co-create the table, not to the closing ceremony. So my call would be to foster intergenerational co-leadership, just like what we're doing right now, this fantastic, amazing intergenerational conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I don't know that we need any more discussion. You've wrapped it all up. No, I'm just kidding. But that was very, very thoughtful and powerful. And, you know, if you represent who's out there, we're turning it over to good hands. And I know you're trying to tell us, though, we need to straighten up some stuff before we turn it over. I heard that in your message, too. What I want to do now is, Dr. Cannon, if you have any opening questions, or do you want me to just go ahead and start the discussion?
Yeah, I'm mindful of the time. And I think, Aya, that was so brilliant. I learned a lot. Thank you, Jonetta, for the 3 points. Okay. And obviously, Diane, I mean, as an icon, it was really interesting to hear your reflections on how we step up into our power. So, you know, and thanks also, Sonia. Sonia and I are classmates from the time we were teenagers. So I don't think I really need to add a single word, Connie. This has been absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
So we have 12 minutes for the exchange. And so anyone who wants to ask a question, challenge a premise, promise something that you're going to do, whatever you want to do with this time. There's just so amazing a group that... you know, and I think the more you give experiences, what went right and what went wrong, and what you think is the future with Ms. Chebbi and her cohort, I think would be a useful conversation.
I saw Her Excellency Mikhail had a point, no? Was your hand up? Oh, sorry.
Mine is.
Dr. Cole.
Well, as someone who might even be able to claim being the oldest among
us. No, I got that covered.
All right. So what difference does a year make? We'll continue our battle. It's a personal battle between the two of us. But I want to speak to a firm commitment to intergenerationality as an incredibly important way that we women of the African diaspora move forward. One more African proverb. The elders know the road. The young can go fast. Mm-hmm. What a combination. I've simply reinterpreted your points, my sister. It's about wisdom and innovation. But what the Black Lives Matter movement, just as an example, urges us to do is to get rid of maternalism. If there's paternalism, there's also maternalism. And to be genuine partners with young women. After all, it was young Black women who founded the Black Lives Matter movement in getting on with this struggle for our liberation.
Thank you. I'm going to challenge the panel to answer the question that was sent in with regard to the role that women play in their own discrimination. The assumption is that our problem generally are men, and because of where they sit. But the question is, don't have women have examples of where they did not facilitate removal of discrimination, or they didn't bring others along and they might have even stood in the way of? Or do you want to even admit to that?
I can jump on that. I want to add to the, I love how the conversation is going to liberation and intergenerational. I'll come to the question though. I want to add one proverb to Madame Kale's proverbs, that when you sit, where you sit when you're old shows where you stood in your youth. And I think this is where I want to be sitting, you know, with elders who are sharing their wisdom and who are, you know, telling us what went wrong and how can we do better. And I think that's an important conversation that doesn't happen often in movements as well. As you rightfully said, yes, the movement was led by young women, but still the movement has to be inclusive of generations and we need to learn from you so we don't continue, you know, going in progression, but in we move forward. On the question though, I think the problem is not men or women, the problem is patriarchy. So if women have, you know, like FGM, there are women who practice FGM on their girls, but it's about women contributing, you know, to the oppression of their own girls. It's about the system of patriarchy that is structurally violent against women and that allows for these practices to continue being normalized. Mm. So I think the fight is against the system. We're not fighting, you know, men and women or you know, even in the feminist movement, when we say, oh, this feminist doesn't represent me and this feminist doesn't represent me and this voice doesn't represent me. At the end of the day, we're fighting a system. And that system is the patriarchal system that keeps women trapped in where we are, whether it's poverty, whether it's these harmful practices, you know, whether it's climbing the ladder of leadership. So it's really, it's the same way in the youth movement, when we say it's not about being old or young, because there are a lot of young people who think very old and who close the door to other young people. But there are a lot of elders in leadership who are many here and who are, you know, my mentors who open the door for young people. So I think it's the conversation should go into what system are we trying to fight? And how can we unite in our fight? So our struggle is intersectional and our strategies are intersectional so we can win that fight. And I think once we move into that, you know, all these sensitivities around who is doing what will go away and we focus on, not get focused on where we want to go.
I think, okay, I'm gonna encourage other comments because one thing, you saved your point from my point of view by the last sentence or so, because I was concerned when you said the system, because somebody runs the system. Somebody's responsible for the system. And if you leave it kind of hanging in the air, then nobody feels responsible for fixing it. So, but you took care of that. You're okay. Yeah.
Yeah. May I say one thing?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm very impressed with this conversation, happening. I think the question about, you know, generations, probably the greatest gift we can bestow our young people is awareness of our place in history. Really, because it makes us all stronger and more enlightened. And I think, what are we doing right now in this conversation? We are identifying problems together, all our generations together. We are sharing experiences. And we do advocate, you know, for solutions, demanding new policies and acting together. But I believe that there's a great need of new platforms and opportunities for young people when they initiate and create openings for themselves. We need to show up. We need to be there to support them. The Black Lives Matter movement is, as we know, a transnational opportunity to stand together with youth. And I like the way you answered these young Africans saying, well, we have enough problems on our continent. Why should we act in solidarity with these, you know, movements coming from? Well, actually, they're transnational. The more we actually cross our voices, our perspectives, the stronger we are. I can relate completely to what, you know, our young friend just said. You know, Pan-Africanism is something, an ideal that our generation really fought for, and it's wonderful to see someone in her 20s, you know, believing in it and wanting, you know, to push it even more forward. It's really amazing. We learn from these young people so much. We continue. This learning process is work in progress, constant work in progress.
Right. Thank you. May I just interject? Aya Chebi, as the African Union Youth Envoy, has really stepped up for leadership globally. And her work is very hard, it's very imaginative, and there are legions of young people and older people like myself who look to Aya for the direction that, for example, we at UNFPA will take vis-a-vis the broad swath of issues which are not just limited to Africa, but represent, I think, the principles that she was putting on the table. And one of the most difficult aspects of gender, and as Black women, we understand race and gender as intersectionality, is the fact that gender is no longer binary. It's no longer male or female only. The fact is, lesbian, gay, transgender, queer, Black people suffer enormously because of patriarchy as well. And one of the functions of gender, and that was the basis of the question, I believe, is to have us criticizing each other and dragging each other down. So I paid attention when Dr. Cole said, the support that we need to lend each other needs to be broad, and it needs to be vocal, and it needs to be visible. So this is also part of our commitment at UNFPA, that we should no longer sweep the thorny issues of gender, which, you know, we struggle with this in every sphere, in every dimension, and it needs to be spoken of in dialogue. So thanks, Aya, for bringing to the, because it's something very much of concern of young people all around the world too. Thank you.
So, can I just?
Please, I was just about to call you, so came in time.
First of all, one of the great matters. It's brought a whole new generation of young people into leadership, and I think that is very important. Can you hear me?
No. Hear me? Try what they said. Move back, and let's see if that works.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. One of the great things about Black Lives Matter is that it brought a whole new generation of young people into leadership. Mm-hmm. And I'm very proud. Someone that worked in my office was elected last year as a British Member of Parliament, a young Black woman. I'm glad to have been able to support her. But I'm wary of an argument which says that women are their own oppressors. I mean, we all know supported other women. We all know women who would argue against feminism, but in the end, we don't want patriarchy to encourage us to turn on each other. The thing I said in my remarks, which maybe people didn't hear, was the importance of coming together and supporting each other. And I put the stress on that rather than saying that in some sense women are their own enemies.
Thank you. Dr. Sachs, I've been in your presence and talking about other issues than health. And I wanted to raise a question that I think you could help us with. And that is this, trying to understand what is the relationship of money, power in money, the economy, and resistance to change. To what extent is it something that is controlling, that is beneath the surface, and you really don't know who can make the change because it's about a lot of people's resources? I just wish you would talk to that. You can straighten the question out, but you know what I'm talking about. I'm just saying money has a lot to do with a lot of stuff that happens and doesn't happen. And I know you know.
No, I don't know, but I think about it a lot. And I think your question is exactly relevant to us trying to go from the aspirational of, let's say, the Declaration of Human Rights to the actual duty and responsibility of implementing those things that the Declaration makes us aspire to. And in order to actually be able to deliver on those things that we aspire to, it does require money. Now, in terms of the rich countries, it's a different, complicated story, and I don't pretend to know all of the parameters. But countries like in sub-Saharan Africa, it is well known and established that a lot of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa actually cannot currently get enough resources in their budgets to address health and education and infrastructure. And that at the same time, the international community, the rich countries, have over and over again promised to deliver on the 0.7% of the rich countries' GNP in order to help these countries that really cannot for the moment deliver on some of the needs. So specifically in the field that I know a little bit better than I know other fields, health, we know, and actually something that we've learned and shown in the Millennium Villages Project in 10 countries in sub-Saharan Africa, you need at least $100 per person per year to have a health system that addresses some of the core issues that burden the communities and especially cause disease and mortality in mothers and children. It costs $100 per person per year. And most countries like Mali or Nigeria can, for the moment, at most, afford about $30 or $40. And most of them do even less. So it really is incumbent upon us, if we really considering ourselves as an international cooperative community, which we aspire to but fault on, then we really do need to help, step up and help. And this is with the funding. And this is true for education also. And the education of young girls is crucial. How are we ever going to deliver on the promise of 2030 education for all, secondary school education for all, which is the first and foremost crucial thing for young girls to be able to have the self-actualization that they deserve. So yes, funding is an issue, number one. And number two, the resolve to actually deliver on the funding is crucial. And I know we don't have time, but I just would like to say one more thing, which is that we have to absolutely have to make sure that the UN continues to be funded and listened to. Look at agencies like UNFPA, exemplary, stellar agency that does so many things all over the world. And now we're using COVID and all sorts of US politics to undermine basic funding for the UN system So we need to speak up about that too.
Thank you. And thank you all. This was an outstanding panel. We learned so much, and you shared so much of yourselves in addition to your content. So thank you, and I look forward to your participating in our webinars and activities going forward. Dakota, you have something to offer?
Dakota? Yes.
Okay.
Africa, Diaspora Network.
Let them go ahead with the video.
Okay.
And that's how long it's taken me to give a red card to all forms of discrimination and violence against women and children across the world. We know that in South Africa, we continue to be haunted by hashtags Am I Next? And movements that showcase women who have brutally been murdered at the hands of men. Siyoyika singabafazi base South Africa. Inhliziyo zethu zibuhlungu. We ask that the men of South Africa stand with us in saying we give a red card to gender-based violence in South Africa. For this is a fight we can't fight alone. And we challenge you as our fathers, brothers, uncles, to isolate the perpetrators around you, to isolate those guilty that you know so that they don't feel comfortable in your presence. How long will we continue to hashtag Am I Next, to live in fear, and for this to be an issue that supposedly has no consequence in South Africa? We can't wait for leadership to stand with us. We in society need to take that stand together and fight it. See Misengembambo in South Africa and make this country uncomfortable and the men who are guilty of such uncomfortable. Enough is enough.
This next session will be focused on discrimination solutions and utilizing case studies. So it is my pleasure to introduce Ms. Toni Ann Broadbur, UN Women Regional Representative for the Caribbean.
Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure to be with everyone today and speaking specifically about solutions and looking at the case studies for these solutions. One of the things that struck me when we were thinking about discrimination is the ways in which it affects Black women specifically. And those ways are influenced by ideology, the discrimination that we see through the ideologies of patriarchy and white supremacy, which promote anti-Blackness and an undervaluing of women. And our colleague earlier, Ms. Chevy, spoke about the fact that we know what to do. We have the Beijing Platform for Action. We have the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. We have this decade in support of persons of African descent. The issue now is looking specifically at the accountability. And what UN Women has been trying to do to support that is looking at CEDAW indicators. Right now we have action coalitions so that countries can stand up and say exactly how they are implementing the Beijing Platform for Action. But one of the ways in which we have gotten to the anti-Blackness ideology is through the Unstereotype Alliance. For those of the persons who are on the call who are in South Africa, we know that there's been a lot right now around advertising that does not praise Blackness in terms of our hair and our skin. And through the Unstereotype Alliance, the representative in South Africa was able to get all of the different companies that are in advertising that have signed on to this to take a stand around this and to develop a plan for how they are going to hold themselves accountable around removing messages on anti-Blackness. We have to look at the institutional discrimination, and this discrimination in our laws, our discriminatory laws, as well as within our own institutions. Right now, UN Women has a Let's Talk About Race series where we have not only instituted a Black caucus, we are looking specifically at our workforce composition and diversity statistics so that we can make concrete steps to improve our recruitment processes, including targeted outreach to persons from the Global South and Black women in particular, so that they can be applying and getting the kind of job mobility within our institutions. But we do need to look at our legislation. We need to look at the representation of women in politics. And it's amazing to have so many powerful women, a sitting vice president right now in Latin America and the Caribbean, as well as the only head of government right now in Latin America and the Caribbean from Barbados. We have to look at the interpersonal discrimination, and many of the colleagues have already spoken about the insidious gender-based violence and the ways in which patriarchy, colonialism, and slavery have impacted the ways in which we interact with one another. One of the things that has struck me is that in spite of slavery, in spite of colonialism, our ancestors, especially our women ancestors, were able to create, to forge relationships and to thrive. And we have to be looking more at the oral storytelling that has not necessarily been reflected in the written word, to look at how the nannies of the Maroons, the Harriet Tubman, how all of our unnamed women and ancestors have been able to get past the discrimination that were barriers to their ability to thrive. And then finally, we have to look at the internalized discrimination, what we believe of ourselves. And this is the work with the young women, and it's fabulous to hear young women saying, we are at the table. We need to be able to not only speak about our experiences, but be uncomfortable about what we have internalized about ourselves and the stories that people have told us about ourselves, our beauty, our lack of beauty, our traditions, especially around our ideologies and beliefs. I wanted to end by saying it is powerful to have the former Governor General of Canada, who is also a Haitian, because we would not be where a Haitian descendant. We would not be where we are in the diaspora without 1804 in Haiti. And that is something that I think we, in order for us to have our discrimination solutions, we need to be working together with each other to find out where our strengths are without the discrimination that we are also sometimes perpetuating within our groups, within the group of women in the diaspora. So I am excited to be here. I'm excited for us to have a further conversation, but UN Women stands ready consistently to make sure that the discrimination solutions are not just talked about, but they are felt and the lived realities of Black women and girls on the ground.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next up is Her Excellency, Epsi Campbell Barr.
Thank you very much. Millions of young people of African descent around the world have joined this year more than ever under the Black Lives Matter movement, because many young people have died at the hands of the police who were supposed to protect them. With them, millions of young people of different identities, groups have raised a desperate cry for equality, a cry of love and respect, because due to their belief that it was enough that ruthless death and battling discrimination cannot be tolerated. This is a new generation that does not want to repeat the mistake of their parents, of keeping silence and being accomplices of injustice, brutality, and pain. This is my shining generation. This journey has been supported by government, civil society, organization, companies, and individuals who today embrace the life of Afro-descendants and manifest a global commitment against racism and racial discrimination. The Costa Rican government sent a message of solidarity to the Afro-American community for the cruel murder of George Floyd, understanding that does have to end many lives. From the Costa Rica state, we categorically condemn racism and show our support to those who must consistently break the silence to achieve right and to dignify life free from threats and discrimination throughout the world. The President of the Republic, the President of the Congress, the President of the Supreme Court of Justice, and the President of the Supreme Electoral Tribunal signed an historical declaration against racism, in which they undertake to promote a series of action and initiative to promote equality and non-discrimination. From my office, we are also articulating a regional campaign against racism with the support of the Central American Integration System, the World Bank, the United Nations Population Fund, and the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights. At the end of this year, we will have a roadmap to implement this initiative in Central America. With the support of the President Carlos Alvarado Quesada, the permanent mission of Costa Rica in New York, headed by the Ambassador Rodrigo Alberto Carazo, had been instructed to promote a resolution at the United Nations in the context of the middle term of International Decade for People of African Descent, of the Decade of African Sustainable Development Goals and the Global Movement of Black Lives Matter. In this resolution, Costa Rica proposed the declaration of August 21st as the World Day of African Descendant People in order to celebrate the extraordinary contribution of African diaspora around the world. As you may know, 100 years ago, the first International Convention on the Situation of Negroes concluded at the Madison Square Garden in New York. As a result of this extraordinary discussion led by the Pan-Africanist Marcus Garvey, the Declaration of Rights of the Negro People of the World was promulgated, inviting international commemoration of 31st of August as a Black People's Day. Dear friends, ethnic racial inequality make up one of the structuring axes for matrix of social inequality in the continent, and racism is a central element of the culture of privilege that still persists and it's reproduced in our countries. Convinced that we'll be capable to dismantling the complex where the fighters, violation of rights and inequalities that affect Afro-descendant population in Latin America, on October 28th, we will present together with UNFPA and ECLAC the report of African descent and matrix of inequality social in Latin America, challenge for inclusion in context of 38 period of session of ECLAC. For this reason, I will invite you to join my country to effort research the society of the future, where there is a room for equality, fairness, and justice without any racism, discrimination, and discrimination in all over the world. Please be capable to work together in this struggle against racism and racial discrimination. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Next, we have Ms. Clementina Acido.
Thank you, and muchas gracias por la presentación anterior. Es un placer escuchar a la vicepresidenta de Costa Rica. I'm talking about inequities in education, inequalities in education faced by women and girls of the diaspora. Education, as we know, is at the heart of the global, of the goals of the international community have set to achieve by 2030. This is one of UNESCO's priority in terms of gender equality in and through education. This is important also because it not only is a human right, but it's what education is what empowers women to achieve development and to achieve sustainable development and peace. There have been great efforts in terms of education and gender parity in the world, worldwide, but there are big differences between regions and within countries. And in general, they get exacerbated by poverty, and those who are most affected are girls. This happens in primary, but also lower secondary and in upper secondary. Even in countries that have achieved gender parity, there is still a lack of completion of upper secondary for the case of women, and in some regions like the South African region, this is quite prevalent, but also in other regions that have achieved parity, gender parity, the problem, for instance, in upper secondary education are the boys. The boys are the ones that are being left behind. So it is extremely important to remember the worldwide issue of education and development and where we are. And it is true that change comes through education, but also not only in terms of incorporating children and girls to the educational system, but in terms of what is transmitted through education and how do we try to avoid the barriers for girls to achieve their life plans, not only education, but in general, that education gives them the tool to succeed in life, to have a life that would benefit their communities and their society. When we look at higher education, it is interesting to see that there has been, if you look worldwide, there is women enroll as much as men. There can be 111 women for 100 men in higher education. In the case of Africa, it would be more 7 women for 100, for 100 men. In the case of Latin America, 78 men for 100 women. But nevertheless, there is a difference of what the women choose as careers. There is, if we look at the science, engineering, information, and communication technology at the core STEM, it is just over 25% of women in these careers. And it's interesting when we see that there are countries which close parity in these areas, in STEM area, that are Algeria, Morocco, and Tunisia. And countries with lower shares in the Western Africa, like Benin, Ghana, and Mali, but also in Western Europe, in the case of Belgium, the Netherlands, and Switzerland, which would impress us. But that is the case. So social norms and value and stereotypes play a role in every society, in developing societies, but also in developed societies, where there are still big barriers, and especially when we're talking about women of color. The educational systems can be also reinforce this inequality and even discrimination. So The type of solutions have to look at the educational system internally, but also at other parts of the society, norms that are very much prevalent at policies and at also at frameworks of action that can enforce different societies and different leaders to achieve these goals. There is an interesting interaction also between intersection between education, migration, and displaced populations. And in these cases, also the case of women and women coming from various countries where there are barriers, they get reinforced in these situations. But one should also look at what has been working, talking here is that women who migrate are women in general that have high skills and high preparation, and that go to societies where there are higher levels of participation and democracy. So they become not only an agent of change in these societies, in the new societies where they are, but also in their societies where they come from. So I think that this brings me to the conversation of the first panel of the importance of the new generation, the intergenerational dialogue between women and between women that go against discrimination and that can bring changes to society that are important also for men. I think the world can be better that way. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your wonderful contributions. Next, we have Ms. Sarah Branco.
Good afternoon, and thank you for having me here. I would like to especially thank the organizers for holding such an amazing event that is so important for women and girls in the diaspora. I'm going to talk about the platform for action and how it addresses racism and women in the diaspora. So the platform for action covers 12 critical areas of concern to achieve equality between women and men. The platform affirms that the intersectionality of gender and racial discrimination causes a higher vulnerability and systematic violations in all of the areas of social life for women and girls. However, it does not directly mention women in the diaspora. In 2019, during the Commission on Status of Women, the CSW, the representatives of the Afro-Latin American, Afro-Caribbean, and from the Diaspora Women Network and of the Brazilian Black Women Network denounced the invisibility of the situation of women of African descent and African women in the world. In Latin American Caribbean, historical and powerful Black women's movement have claimed for different society with a new social pact free of violence and oppression. Women and girls of the diaspora are the ones who live in the worst conditions, and there are social indicators that make this reality explicit. To exemplify, in Brazil, 56% of the victims of gender-based violence are women of African descent. White men make, in average, 159% more than women of African descent work in the same position. Yet, in 2018, out of 513 members in Congress, 52 were women, and only 7 of them were women of African descent, even though we represent 29% of the population, the biggest group. All of this data and the centers of oppression took in the year of 2015, 50,000 Black Brazilian women to march in the streets of Brasilia against racism, violence, and for the well-being. Back to the platform, it also acknowledges that gender and discrimination and all of other forms of discrimination, in particular racism, racial discrimination, continue to cause threat to women's enjoyment of their human rights and fundamental freedoms. In fact, women of the diaspora are the ones who live in extreme exclusion and are the worst discriminated against regarding the centers of oppression. The platform addresses racism and racial discrimination as an obstacle that we must overcome to achieve and accelerate its full implementation. More recently, since COVID-19 pandemic, the situation of women and girls of African descent became even worse. The gap of social inequality increased, and it may take years to close. Thus, all of the power structures and decision-making places, private and public sectors, especially those in the public policy field, demand the presence of women of the diaspora. Therefore, at this moment of the 25th anniversary of the Declaration of Beijing and the implementation of the Platform of Action, it's essential to acknowledge that women of the diaspora can no longer be ignored. This is the way to move towards the achievement of gender equality in the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Our next panelist will be Ms. Nanhandla Jihani.
Thank you, Dakota. Good morning, good evening, bonjour, sanbonani, all protocol observed. I am Nonhlanhla Jihani, Mbandeni, Majalinyama, Itingaphuma, Imbongo Athi, Iyamila. It is an honor to be amongst all these powerful women who are sharing all the wisdom with us today. Why is it that in 2020 we are still faced with inequalities and increased gender-based violence? Women are the bearers of the society. However, they are still at the back foot if compared to men. Women and men must have equal access to opportunities for financial independence, education, and personal development. It is for this reason that Red Card Campaign was initiated in July 2019 during FIFA Women World Cup, and it was launched globally this year during the International Women's Day on the 6th of March. With the aim to collect 1 million pledges by 2022, so that all people, men and women, are treated equally with the same rights and respect in all places and all types of activities. In sport, including business, they should receive the same media attention and be equally recognized for their successes. This initiative is correlated with the 5th of the 17th SDGs adopted by the government at the UN in September 2015 to create a more equitable, prosperous, and peaceful world by 2030. A world free of sexism, prejudice, extreme poverty, and hunger. Limited gains in gender equality and women's rights made over the decades are in danger of being rolled back due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The UN Secretary General said in April 2020, urging governments to put women and girls at the center of their recovery effort. COVID-19 has demonstrated and exposed the disparities that still exist between men and women. We cannot hide anymore, but need to come out and vigorously address it. As a result, we continue implementing our plans using the power of arts, culture, and sport, the language that is understood globally to empower women despite the current COVID-19. If women are not empowered, gender-based violence will continue to rise. We have seen it here in South Africa, where GBV cases rose at an alarming rate in South Africa and the world. And here at home, it has been declared a pandemic. And also in Liberia, rape has been declared a state of emergency. And therefore, government together with civil society are combining efforts to address this challenge. We commend efforts made as today is the first International Equal Pay Day. Red Card programs have set out to touch on various interventions to achieve gender equality. Some of the programs are already underway, but need support in order to maintain momentum that yields desired impact. People want to see change. However, we tend to exclude the perpetrators of violence. It's key for strong dialogues to be held with men and work together to end the GBV. Men need to be in the forefront of eradicating discrimination and violence against women and girls. We need to find balance between a boy child and a girl child. As the saying in Zulu says, "Ligqotshwa lisemanzi," It is bent at an early stage. Grooming and education for both must happen during early childhood. In closing, we cannot do this alone, and we cannot continue to work in silos. The world needs to stand up with us and pledge to give the red card to all forms of discrimination and violence against women and girls in all countries. Time is not on our side. We therefore call upon all of you to pledge on www.redcardpledge.com and let us collect the 1 million pledges that will give us a voice to enable us to call upon world leaders to address the SDG 5 gender equality. Our own president, Cyril Ramaphosa, said, "We must not look away and we must face gender equality heads on and declare that enough is enough." Yes, enough is enough. Women's lives matter. And the Red Card campaign is the solution. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Jihani. For the duration, for the balance of the time, I would like to encourage a discussion between all of the panelist members. And we have several questions that were posed on Facebook and some comments. So the first question that I will bring to you all is, the question online is, for all isolated women, how do you break the glass ceiling in separate organizations?
Can you repeat? Because it got broke the...
Oh, yes. Okay, the question posed online is, for all isolated women, how do you break the glass ceiling in the organizations?
Dakota, can I please take that? Yeah. As Red Card, we continuously engage, you know, with digitism and social media campaigns to raise awareness and to also mobilize the global community to support, you know, the women that don't have a voice. We create documentaries and movies to stop the GBV and the women empowerment. And also what we found as well is, you know, when you use the power of your music, you know, here in South Africa, we've seen Jerusalem, I'm sure everyone knows it. You know, it was, it traveled all over the world where we saw all the great people singing and dancing, you know, so that is what we also doing. And also using, you know, fashion as ventures for platforms for women to come up and actually have a voice. And in the 2020, during the fourth industrial revolution, we cannot sit back and not take advantage of technology. Therefore, we're using, you know, your social media. We also are going, you know, to the rural communities and make sure that the people they have and find their voices. And as well, we need to build the behavior to change, the behavior of men and boys to change. And with that, you know, we don't work in isolation, but we bring everyone together to find a solution. Thank you.
So Dakota, I wanted to also come in here as well, because it's amazing what is happening with the Red Card campaign, especially around GBV. The work that is being done as well to break the glass ceiling as it pertains to economic empowerment, I think cannot only be done by individual women. We are stronger when we are together. When we think about the movie Hidden Figures, I think that's when businesses start to see that when you allow Black women and women of color to attain their fullest potential, you as a business as well succeed. We have data on this about women. What we need to now start looking at is doing more analysis with an intersectional lens about the data from a sex perspective, a gender perspective, as well as a race and ethnicity perspective. UN Women supports the Women's Empowerment Principles with the Global Compact that companies can sign on to say what they're going to do to ensure that they stand for gender equality. What we need to start doing is merging that with actions around what you're going to do to end racial discrimination as well.
Wow, that was an amazing comment. Would anybody else like to comment on the question? So my next question will actually be directed to everybody. Did anyone hear a comment by any of the other speakers or panelists that raises questions or comments on your part?
I'm going to take space like Miss Universe Zozi Tunze tells us to do. Did have a question and or just a comment around education, because in the Caribbean, we see a lot of women having higher levels of certification. And so it is often said that the crisis is among the boys and we're leaving the boys behind. And I wonder, because when we look at the employment statistics, we don't see women having more employment. So the increased certification does not necessarily or is not necessarily reflected in increased employability for women. And I was wondering if there was any information that we can get or any move towards having more information around education and linking it to growth economy spaces that our colleague Nomlanda spoke about in the innovation technologies, if we're seeing more women in those growth areas as well, because it seems that COVID as well has hit most of the industries that women are most in and Black women are most in as well. So that was my question. And then one other question around education. The first time I heard about Toussaint Louverture, I was in university and I was educated in the Caribbean and in Canada. And so I'm wondering what kind of policies are we going to be doing in the Caribbean, not in the Caribbean, across the world, sorry, in the world, to ensure that Black stories and stories of our resistance, of our successful resistance, are told to persons as young as two. I have a two-year-old now. I would like him to hear it in school as well, not only from me and his father.
Yes, that's a fantastic, Hello? Am I? well, excellent question and comment, actually, with regard to education. It is true that the higher levels of education doesn't represent immediately in the labor market, but it is the first necessary condition for that to happen. And I think it is happening in Latin America. It is happening in the Caribbean. We have a wonderful example in Costa Rica as to how women get into leadership positions. And I would say that in these countries, this is happening, but there are still resistance. And there are still resistance in specific areas when you see the industry or the world of business, there are less women in top areas than men. But I would say that's a way to start. And the other one is to learn also from societies where they have proactive measures to have participation of women in the parliament, in the different positions of power, or in boards in companies. And I think these policies are necessary. I don't think that it comes out naturally. We realize that in our daily life that we see things that may not.
To Connie, we're closing this session. We're going to close in 7 minutes. Yeah. We're closing.
Okay, so thank you so much for your comments, but we have unfortunately ran out of time, even though this is a topic that we could actually discuss for a very long time, especially around the areas of job discrimination and even though highly qualified women, all qualifications. So next, we are going to another video. In the say, the mayor of the city that is the nation's capital made a larger than life statement for social justice. The video, Black Lives Plaza with Mayor Muriel Bowser, Washington, D.C.
And we want to call attention today to making sure our nation is more fair and more just, and that Black lives and Black humanity matter in our nation. We're here, people of all backgrounds and beliefs from all eight wards of Washington, D.C. We all want to be here together in peace to demonstrate that in America, you can peacefully assemble. You can bring grievances to your government, and you can demand change. And that's my message today. God bless you all.
So, Dr. Diallo, let us hear from the co-host, and then we'll hear the summary statement from Arden.
All right. So we will hear from Her Excellency. Dr. Kahneman and then Her Excellency. All right, Kahneman?
Yes. Well, thank you so much. This has been such a rich discussion, and I'm glad that it's the first of more to come, because there was so much more that could be said. And I will be brief, knowing that we're past time. My major point is from the perspective of UNFPA and our understanding that bodily integrity and sexual and reproductive health and rights is really at the core of rights and choices for women in this era, and that Black women should not be disadvantaged by this. And progress is going to demand vigilance. In order to move further, the struggle continues. We are going to have to stand up for human rights and for the health and dignity and well-being of a woman or a girl wherever she may be. And the dream of an Afro-descendiente girl is as important as anyone else's on the planet. We've got to figure out how to help her not just to survive, but to thrive. For UNFPA, our commitment is unwavering. We are very involved, as is Her Excellency, the Vice President of Costa Rica, Epsi Campbell, in making sure that the decade for African independence is not only sotto voce. We need to raise our voices and look at the processes of not just the United Nations, but in every country. How do we ensure that African descended people continue to prosper and are not left behind? I really appreciated the comments of Sara Branco and Clementina and others, bringing to the fore that the fight is in our backyard. So I would say that while the challenges are significant, we're rallying together to do something. We're not just talking about a problem. The policy may be there, but how do you bring that into a reality? Can we change the status quo? Of course, the answer is yes, but it's going to take a lot of effort to get there. And we're willing to do this. I think, you know, as we heard from Diane Abbott, it was very inspiring to know that you stay the course and you bring the next set of people up with you. That's part of breaking the glass ceiling in answer to that question. So we are attentive to what countries are doing, because in fact, there are countless international agreements that already offer a roadmap. What it demands is us raising the demand and shepherding that, so that whether it's an electoral process, a multilateral process, or just a girl who is being victimized by a teacher in a school, her sense of self-worth is preserved, and she is free to speak, and we listen. So ultimately, I think these commitments to gender and racial equality transform lives. They make things better for people. When a woman is better off, you know that family is better off. So I will just exhort us to continue to keep rising, as Maya Angelou exhorted us. Still, we rise. Thank you so much to Arden for pulling this together, and we were so proud to co-host. Thank you.
Excellent. Vice President F.C. Campbell.
Yeah. It's been wonderful to hear this trend and enthusiasm for all the women who are participating in this summit. I would like to extend my thanks to African Renaissance and Diaspora Network, the United Nations Population Fund, and the Permanent Mission of Costa Rica in New York for organizing this extraordinary event. I would like to conclude with the example of Costa Rica, a small Central American democracy that has demonstrated throughout its history that it's possible to achieve what seems impossible. 71 years ago, a brave generation of men and women decided to exchange weapons for good with the abolition of the army. For decades, we have decided to preserve our forest and advance nature-based solution. We work to achieve equality between men and women. We recognize that we have pending tasks, but for the most part of the population, we advocate for the common good and well-being. I'm completely sure that together with this shining generation of young, enthusiastic and commitment people, we can work towards the abolition of racism and racial discrimination as a fundamental step to lay the foundation of just, equitable, and prosperous society. In this time to forge a more sustainable, fairer, freer, and more inclusive future. Count of the full support of Costa Rica to work in that direction with the aim of deliberating a better planet to next generation. This virtual summit has been very successful. Natalia, please let's organize a face-to-face conference here in Costa Rica the second semester of 2021, strengthening the agenda in Nairobi and the Beijing Plus 25, and learning about the shining generation. Please make it together. We can make one in this side of the world, another in Africa, and keep in talking between diaspora women to work for a better world. And please, Jibril, join us. Join us for a dream in a world that is the justice and the non-discrimination. It is a reality for Black people and for all the people in this world. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank the co-hosts.
I'm going to put my microphone on to clap the vice president. <Okay. laughs>
So, Dr. Diallo, we were going to have notes from Arden and then your closing remarks. Are you comfortable with that?
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
So, Dr. Strobel and Janice Mathis, attorney.
Thank you very much. I am delighted to be with Janice Mathis on behalf of Arden to provide the summary notes that Arden has prepared. It should be noted that on the 18th of September, 2020, the Republic of Costa Rica, the United Nations Population Fund, and the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network convened today's Women of the Diaspora Virtual Global Summit on Gender and Racial Discrimination in close collaboration with the United Nations Entity for Gender Equality and the Empowerment of Women and the National Council for Negro Women. Over 1,300 participated in the summit. As context, we are noting that peace cannot prevail as long as oppression, poverty, injustice, and inequality infect the heart of society. To aspire toward peace is to work toward ensuring that the marginalized, disenfranchised, and forgotten among us are not alone. All persons must be able to pursue their destiny, potential, and promise without being discriminated against based on gender, race, or other status. They must be empowered to do so with confidence and conviction, so long as it harms none. The world is witnessing the largest generation of youth in history. Young people, and especially young women, must be provided the support and platform to advocate for their rights and be strong supporters of gender equality. This is especially true for women and girls who face multiple and intersecting forms of discrimination, including racial discrimination. Education is extremely important inside and outside the classroom in ending gender and race-based violence and discrimination and xenophobia. In the game of football, a red card signifies a serious and inexcusable infraction of the rules. We emphasize that discrimination and violence against women and girls must be viewed as serious and inexcusable violations of the rules and norms of society that should not be tolerated. In 2013, the United Nations General Assembly proclaimed 2015 to 2024 to be the International Decade for People of African Descent, with the theme, Recognition, Justice, and Development. Opinions and facts that we have heard shared during this summit. Women and girls of the diaspora are doubly burdened because they face discrimination and violence, not only on account of their gender, but also their ancestry. We live in a male-dominated world where men dictate and women and girls are expected to follow, even on matters as fundamental to a woman's personhood. In response, we should amplify the voices of women and girls, stand up and speak out against those who impair their equal dignity and rights to help open a path for women and girls. This should be a world where every woman and girl will live free from violence and harm, and where the rights and potential of people everywhere are respected, protected, and fulfilled. We should strive to build peace in the home and in our societies by ensuring that the rights, choices, and bodies of women and girls everywhere are fully their own. Amidst the global COVID-19 health crisis, incidents of domestic violence, as well as other forms of violence, have been on the rise. There should be zero tolerance for men and boys who perpetrate or encourage violence against women or girls. Further, the structural economic disadvantages faced by women have been exacerbated by the global pandemic, with ending poverty being a linchpin of achieving the sustainable development goals. Ensuring women's economic empowerment must be addressed and advanced in the aftermath and recovery post-COVID-19. Women's health and well-being is important in achieving sustainable development. The right of women to control all aspects of their health is important. In particular, their sexual and reproductive health is basic to their empowerment. I now gladly hand this to Janice Mathis, my co-chair, to discuss the proposed next steps.
Thank
Maybe Beth, you could start, because you did it together. You could start it.
Propose next steps.
Oh, there she is.
I'm so sorry, I forgot to mute. Thank you, Beth, and thank you, Connie. Propose next steps. All should join together in the spirit of our common humanity to denounce discrimination, racism, and violence based on gender and race as repugnant violations of human rights, and commit to advancing universal equality, justice, and dignity. Because of the importance of partnerships in achieving the world we want and deserve, those who identify as men and boys should be called on to be equal partners in the struggle toward ending all forms of discrimination and violence against women and girls. All should ensure that leaders who consciously or recklessly perpetuate gender or race-based discrimination or violence or xenophobia or any kind should be held accountable for their action and inaction. There should be commitments to ensuring that the young in our society are raised to respect the equality and dignity of all human beings in pursuit of the vision of a generation with zero gender and race-based discrimination and violence, and that they are provided the space and support to make their own voices heard, particularly young women. Investing in women is investing in the future. Accordingly, we call upon the international community, governments, the private sector, civil society, academia, the media, and the world of arts, sports, and culture to invest in the education, health, safety, and social, educational, political, psychological, and economic empowerment of women and girls. It is important that we ensure that all members of our human family commit to giving a red card to all forms of discrimination and violence against women and girls by signing the Red Card Pledge at www.redcardpledge.com. We must make full use of existing global processes, including the 25th anniversary of the Beijing Declaration and Platform for Action, and the Program International Conference on Population and Development, and related processes such as generation equality, to drive broad support and concrete actions toward the elimination of racial and gender-based discrimination. We must intensify our efforts for the full, effective, and accelerated implementation of the International Conference on Population and Development Program of Action. Key actions for the further implementation of the Program of Action of the ICPD, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, and mobilize stakeholders across sectors towards zero sexual and gender-based violence and harmful practices, and the elimination of structural barriers that hinder the realization of the full socioeconomic potential of women and girls. The conveners of the Women of the Diaspora Summit should convene further summits focused on economic opportunities and equity, safety concerns, education, environment, health, civil and political empowerment, and sports and arts. Efforts to have the international community recognize 31 August as the Day of Afro Descendants should be supported. And there is one final end note that we've been asked to share with you, and that is, we express our deep appreciation and congratulations to the Republic of Costa Rica for its continued leadership and commitment to an inclusive and human rights agenda of people and communities of African descent and of the empowerment of women and girls. Thank you. Constance, Jabril.
Thank you. When you've had such a powerful session where individuals have gone way beyond the time that was allotted, all we can say is that I'm speaking to you from Dakar, Senegal right now,
is that I will go down on my knees and take my hat off and say that, thank you. Secondly, this was held within the framework of the United Nations General Assembly, because we wanted to make sure that we reaffirm through this virtual summit of women of the diaspora, the paramount principle of human rights enshrined in Article 1 of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights. So my final point is that we at the African Renaissance and Diaspora Network, we, the government of Costa Rica, we, the United Nations Population, United Nations Population Fund, are most grateful for you, to you, because we know that together we can create a better world where sisters can make real choices in every aspect of their lives, a better world where we can create daughters who are not told by men that they can, what they can and cannot do with their bodies, a world where we can create our mothers, where our mothers can go everywhere, can walk freely without fear of being subject to sexual assault or sexual harassment. And together we can create that world. And that is why we are so encouraged by your presence here, by this enlightening presence. And thank you very much. And we look forward to staying in touch. Thank you again. And over to you, Connie Newman.
Connie Newman wants you to have the last say. Goodbye, everybody, and thank you.
And by so doing, I bring to a close this first virtual summit of women of the diaspora on fighting violence, discrimination, and racism. Thank you very much.
Okay.
May the last one burn into flame.